only got one passage to read here today, and then reference a couple other passages maybe, and see where this goes. Let's all open our Bibles to Luke chapter 19. Bill referred to Zacchaeus in his word earlier, so I'll just read about Zacchaeus, and we'll talk about Zacchaeus and Jesus for a little bit. I've always enjoyed this story. Luke chapter 19, we'll start at verse 1. And he, Jesus, entered Jericho and was passing through. And there was a man named Zacchaeus, and he was a chief tax collector and was rich. And he was seeking to see who Jesus was, but on account of the crowd he could not, because he was small of stature. So he ran on ahead and climbed up into a sycamore tree to see him, for he was about to pass that way. And when Jesus came to the place, he looked up and said to him, "Zacchaeus, hurry, come down, for I must stay at your house today." So he hurried and came down and received him joyfully. And when they saw it, they all grumbled, "He has gone in to the guest of a man who is a sinner." And Zacchaeus stood and said to the Lord, "Behold, Lord, half of my goods I've given to the poor, and if I've defrauded anyone of anything, I restored it fourfold." And Jesus said to him, "Today salvation has come to this house, since he also is the son of Abraham. For the Son of Man has come to seek and to save the lost." I've chose this little portion here today to do a little bit of ministering on, that if we would pattern our lives after Jesus in this little story alone, that what Jesus did with this man Zacchaeus for just the short time that he was with him, I've studied this, and I've learned so much, and I've put together a little pattern of service, I call it. And the five words that I've picked to talk about here today, and these all pertain to how Jesus dealt with Zacchaeus. And these five words all begin with A. I'm going to call these five words awareness, availability, acceptance, abiding, and abandonment. And these five words tell us how Jesus dealt with Zacchaeus in this short time, and how we can deal with others in our lives around us, in the community, in the workplace, wherever we're at. These five things here, if we keep them, and we're conscious about this, if we just think about these, like Jesus did, we can maybe impact someone's life in our life. Okay, so here we have Jesus is traveling from, he's traveling towards Jerusalem, coming to the end of his life here, and he's going through Jericho, and as he's traveling through Jericho, he comes upon this man, which I don't think is any accident, but he stumbles across this man that's up in a sycamore tree because he's a little man he couldn't see. And he stops at him and he says, "I need you to come down out of that tree. I want to abide in your house." So that if we look at this first word that I've chosen, awareness, Jesus was aware of this man up in a tree. Now there was many people in that crowd. There was a lot of people. But Jesus picked out this one man. He was aware, and like I said before, it was no accident that Jesus was traveling through Jericho to see this one man. And when he saw him up in a tree, you know, he could have walked. I always say when people, you know, ask me, "Well, what should we do with this up here? Or should we put some design, or what should we do?" I said, people don't walk around looking up and looking down most of the time. You're looking right here. So Jesus, when he's walking, he looks up in a tree and sees this man. It was no accident. And Jesus tells Zacchaeus, and he called him by name, and he said, "Come down out of that tree." And so Zacchaeus comes down out of the tree, and he says, I want to go to your house tonight, and I'm going to spend some time and you know, to be with you. And so Jesus was aware of Zacchaeus to call him by name. And awareness is having the knowledge of something through alertness. So he was aware that Zacchaeus was up here. He saw him, he recognized him, and he said, come down to me. Now the people of this area, they weren't real happy with this because they said, this guy's a sinner. I don't know what they thought they were, okay? But they thought, they said, this guy's a sinner. He's a tax collector. He takes our money and gives it to Rome. But he was only doing his job. But they didn't like this man. And then when Jesus went to his house to stay with this man, they're thinking, man, what is going on here? I mean, here we have a guy. We have the Lord Jesus Christ, and he's going to stay with this man that is a notorious sinner. He takes our money. He's not a real good guy. Why would Jesus give this guy the time of day? He's a no good guy, right? We don't like him. Why would Jesus do this? We have to be so careful in the people around us of what's on the outside of them. Like, they thought this guy was a no good for nothing. You know, he's worthless. We have no time for this guy. He's a sinner. Why would Jesus give him the time of day? And we got to be so careful that we don't do that to the people in the workplace, to the people wherever we're at, whatever we're doing, whether we're at a sporting event, where if we're seeing people on a regular basis. We can't judge people of what we see on the outside, what they do, who they are. We don't know a person's problems or concerns or worries or what their struggles or temptations are. But we need to be aware of the people around us because we just don't know who God wants us to deal with and who He wants us to take time and spend time with. If we read in Proverbs 17 and 9, and I wrote this down out of the NLT. It says, discarding other person's faults, preserve love. Tell about them separately. Discarding another person's fault, preserve love. Tell about them separates close friends. I might have missed something. But anyway, we can read it in the, it didn't, I don't have that marked right now. But basically what it's saying is, don't look at a person on the outside and judge them, because it's God wants us to love everyone like He loves. Because if you go and you start separating between who I need to deal with and who I shouldn't, or who I could talk to, who I need to be aware of, all we're going to do is separate them and put them farther from us. And we don't want to do that. We just don't know what is ahead of us in dealing with somebody in a sensitive way and to deal with them in a godly way. The next thing we want to look at, the way Jesus dealt with Zacchaeus here, was his availability. Availability can be gotten, had, or reached, handy, or accessible. Jesus made himself available when he said, I must be a guest in your home today. Jesus told Zacchaeus, I want to come and spend time with you today. And Jesus was a very busy person. He was always moving. He was always doing something. But he made himself available from his journey to Jerusalem. He stopped, he was aware of Zacchaeus, what his need was, and he made himself available to spend time with Zacchaeus at that time. Just like when he was on his way, in Luke 8, we read about Jesus on his journey when he went to meet with Jairus' and healed his daughter. And on the way, he met the lady that had an issue of blood. There were so many people that day that was pulling at him and talking to him and stuff. But he stopped and made himself available for Jairus' daughter and for this woman that had that issue. There are so many people in our life that we can make ourselves available to, that we can make ourselves known to by just talking to them and seeing a little bit of their life, that even just listening sometimes is the best thing. But to make yourself available for a person's need, like Jesus did when Zacchaeus, he went to be in Zacchaeus' home with him. He made himself available. So he was aware of Zacchaeus. He made himself available at Zacchaeus's, what Zacchaeus needed. And so when Jesus went to his house, he may have had dinner. They may have spent some time. But there are always places that we can go and make ourselves available. I know a lot of us live really busy lives, and we're always on the go. I know a guy. He goes to a juvenile detention home, a boys' juvenile detention home, every Tuesday night. Now this guy's self-employed, and self-employed people usually stay pretty busy. You know, they don't have a work schedule. They're always business. If there ain't something to do, this guy is self-employed. But every Tuesday night, he takes a couple young men from the church he goes to, and they go to a boys' detention center where kids go that have gotten themselves in trouble. And he sits and talks to these young men, and he listens to their problems. And what he goes, you know, Paul, I'm no psychiatrist. I don't know how to deal with these kids, but they just need somebody that isn't telling them what to do. Like the counselors and stuff at this place are telling them, okay, well, you did this wrong. Now, he goes, all I do is listen to them. And they tell me their problems. And they tell me, you know, how this goes wrong and this ain't right. And he goes, and then I always got to sneak in the Word of God. I always tell them about Jesus, how Jesus died on the cross for them. And he goes, he's been doing this for about 10 or 15 years. He goes, probably about 10 years ago, he goes, I had a young man. I came in and he wasn't there. And I said, I'm going to say Jonathan. Where's Jonathan? I asked the one counselor, where's Jonathan at? They said, oh, he moved out. I mean, he's done with his stay here. We talked to him. We feel he's safe enough to go back into society and all that. And he goes, man, I really enjoyed talking to him. I'd like to know if I could catch up with him someday somewhere. Can you give me any? Well, they weren't allowed to give him any information about him because of all the privacy and all the privacy stuff. Somehow, some way, he found somebody that knew about this kid. And he went and found the kid. And here the kid got saved and was going to another church, not because he didn't live near the church where my friend goes to. He was going to another church and being involved in everything. So you just don't know what's going to happen or where. And the same guy told me one time, he went to, he did a little bit of everything, this guy. Matter of fact, Bill, you met him at the parade down there, Christmas parade one time. I was talking to him, red haired, like reddish brown hair. His name was Joe. I don't know if you remember Joe, but anyway, his name is Joe Miller. But I was talking to Joe, and he went to cut down a tree for a guy one time, a big tree, and the guy was just seeming to have a bad day. Well, let me just tell you, I'll shorten the story a lot. He never cut the tree down, but he sat there and talked to the guy for 5 hours. He made himself available to this gentleman that needed more than his tree cut down. And this is what I'm saying, that we need to make ourselves available, that you just don't know what's going to happen, who we're going to run into in our everyday life, and what might come out of it. The third thing that Jesus did with Zacchaeus was he accepted, approved, reception, accessibility. Jesus would spend time with this guy in his house. He accepted this guy, even though everybody else thought he was a sinner. He was the worst sinner in town. He was a tax collector. He took our money. He wasn't a guy that you'd want to spend time with him. But Jesus did. Jesus accepted him for who he was, as a sinner that needed salvation. And Jesus spent time with him and stayed at his house with him. And through this, we can spend time with people. If we can accept people for who they are. I'm right now doing work in a grocery store. And I'm amazed at some of the people that come in there and how they're dressed and how they talk and how they, you know, like, I just don't find myself spending time with them, going out to dinner, doing anything like that. It's just like we're like in two different worlds. But that's not what Jesus is saying to do. That's not what God wants us to do. Like, these people come over and start talking to us. They don't have no teeth. They have $2 worth of clothes on. They're, you see them going through the line, and they're paying with a access card. And you know, they just... But we have to accept people for who they are. They're people on this earth that God has put on this earth. And because they're not like us, that don't mean there's something wrong with them. We have to accept people, and it can be challenging maybe. Maybe it's a challenge that we need to step up to the plate and, you know. But Jesus accepted Zacchaeus for the sinner he was. And what these people thought of him, he took him and he spent time with him and accepted him. I can't help but thinking of the story of Joseph when all his brothers came down to Egypt to get food. How he could have so easily told them, no, you don't get no food. I don't care how much money you got. What you guys did to me back how many years ago? Not revealing it, but just saying, no, I don't got no food for you guys. Turn around, go back to wherever you came from. No, he did. He accepted it. No, regardless of what they did to him, he still loved them and accepted them for who they were and what their need was. And he didn't reject them or send them away. Abiding. Jesus abided, continuing without change, enduring, lasting. Jesus would go to this man's house and spend time and be with this guy. He abided with him. He spent time with Zacchaeus. And you don't really know a person from their outside until you've abided with them and spent time with them and get to know someone. Until you've walked 100 miles with somebody. Until you've seen the world through somebody else's eyes and spent time with them. Until you get close enough to know a person. You know, the old, I've used this before. I know about, let's say, President George Bush. I know who he was. I knew he was from Texas. I knew some stuff about him, you know. But I didn't know him like his wife did. Now, you don't get to know somebody until you spend time and abide with them to really know what they're like. So we shouldn't look at a person for what we see initially until you've got to know somebody and walk with them and spend time with them. And it's then, when the more time you spend, that you get to know somebody and you can build a relationship, and then you can introduce God into their life and talk to them and spend time with them. That is what Jesus did here. Jesus very easily could have said, come down out of that tree. You're a sinner. Yeah, we know you need Jesus. I mean, you need to accept God for what he says in his word and moved on. But he took the time and he abided with Zacchaeus. He got to know Zacchaeus a little bit better and he spent time with him. And we need to spend time with the people we around us, whether it's family that we don't always see. I have family members on Tammy's side of the family. I see them twice a year, if I'm lucky. And so, there are times when some of the best conversations I have with some of my other relatives on the other side, some of Tammy's family, I could spend more time. I could call them up and say, hey, let's go do dinner. Let's just get together and have some pizza and talk and stuff and get to know and spend time and get to know people. But the only way you get to know people is to abide and spend time with them. And the last one that I want to talk about, what Jesus did with a service to Zacchaeus, is abandonment. And I think this is the toughest one. And that is to give up, stop, quit, or desert. Now, I'm not talking about with the person. I'm talking about of your own needs. It's so hard for us to break plans, to stop doing what we're doing, to go and change and do something of service for God. And you say, yeah, but I see it so often, so many times, that there are things that need to be done. There's issues. There are service that we can do, dealing with people, and we just, we had plans to do. I had plans to do this, and I'm going to tell you right now. I'll throw myself to the wolves here and say that this past Christmas season, when we had our Christmas parade down there, and I had made plans to go to that football game on Friday after Thanksgiving instead of going to our parade, you know. I enjoyed my family. I enjoyed going to that football game and stuff, and that was good. But I don't know who I would have ran into down there, down in town. I don't know who I would have seen down there that maybe I could have shared a word with, or given them a text, or talked to them, or if I would have abandoned my plans, maybe I could have done something good for God down in town there. And you don't know. I'm just using that as a little example of when Jesus calls and when we can do something for Him. Was that Del Vitale that said from, I think he said from this platform, it's not what I can do for God. It's what God can do with me. God doesn't need me to do anything for Him. He's the Almighty God. He don't need me to do anything for Him. But what He can use me for is what we got to focus on. And by being aware of our surroundings, making ourselves available, accepting people for who they are, abiding with them, and abandoning what we would really like to do and do what we need to do for God is what service is for God. And that's what the Lord Jesus Christ did. Whenever He stopped on that journey as He was passing through Jericho, He stopped and He abandoned whatever He was doing at that point, made a little turn and spent time with Zacchaeus. You know that Jesus had to have so much going on inside His head at that point. Where He was headed, what He was up against. He was heading to Jerusalem for His final days. And how He could stop and think about Zacchaeus and his need and not continuing on that journey. And I can't help but think of the rich man that we read about in Mark chapter 10 here a couple weeks ago, about how he asked God, what can I do to serve? And He goes, sell all that you have. He wasn't willing to abandon that lifestyle. He wasn't willing to give up and do away with all his riches and all his... And he went away sorrowful because he wasn't. And I wonder how many days after that rich man thought. He wasn't a happy man, probably. He had all that riches and all that wealth, and I wonder how many times he thought that whenever he asked Jesus that question, he said, well, get rid of everything you have, sell all that you got, and follow me. I wonder how many times in his future after that time did he think of that, what Jesus told him about give up everything you have and follow me. He was very disappointed when Jesus told him to do that. And he didn't do it. I wonder how many times that came back to him. So in our life, if we go through life and we make ourselves aware, make ourselves available, we accept and abide and we abandon, I think it's a place that we could try to work towards to deal with people, to see them to God and see them to Christ. We just don't know how much time is left on this earth and what we're up against here. And just to be able to make ourselves available and just think about these five things that I've pointed out that we could try to deal with those around us in our workplace, in our school, in customers of ours, whatever it might be. You just don't know. I ran into a gentleman here Friday, and in about 3 minutes. Well, we were working. I gotta admit, we were working in a church. We were working in a church up in Catan, but it was a Lutheran church. And in about 3 minutes, I'm into a discussion with this gentleman about Abraham and Isaac, you know. And I asked him, I said, "So, what do you think about Abraham willing to sacrifice Isaac? You know, he had all that faith, but yet he turns around and then kind of lies to Pharaoh about Sarah being his wife or sister." And I said, within a couple minutes, me and this gentleman are in a discussion about God and the Bible and stuff. And so it does happen. You just don't, you know, you don't have to work real hard. You don't have to work real hard to get into discussions on the Lord Jesus Christ or God or some of these things. They can happen pretty quickly. And when it does, you got to take full advantage of it and run with it. So if we could just remember these couple things, maybe it might help us all out to lead lives to Christ. Let's close in prayer. Father in heaven, we thank you for this time that we have together. We thank you for your Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. Father, we thank you for this little story that we could read about Jesus and Zacchaeus, how he made himself available, and he gave up everything else at that moment in time to deal with this man. As bad as people thought of him and whatever they thought, that he could spend time with this man and love this individual just like anybody else, even though those around him didn't. Father, we just ask you to be with us throughout this day and this week. Father, we thank you for this time that we have. We thank you for the gospel that was preached. Father, we ask you to watch over us and be with us. We thank you for the food that will be provided here for us to eat as nourishment to our body here in a few moments. So, Father, we just thank you for this time together in your Son. In his name we pray.